The last two lectures have been remarkably abstract. It's easy, perhaps, to forget that this dialogue is titled The Republic. The Greek word is politeia, related to our word politics. It's a very reasonable question to ask at this stage of our study: what in the world does all this abstract philosophizing have to do with politics? What does it have to do with justice? Socrates, at the beginning of Book 7, begins the process of answering that question, of returning us to the basic issues of politics. He does so here at the beginning of Book 7 by reciting what has become one of the most famous little stories or parables in the history of Western philosophy. It's the parable of the cave, and it runs from 514a to 521b. This is a story that many high school students study, and it's well known to many people throughout all levels of education. And I use the word education there deliberately, because the cave, says Socrates, is meant to be an image of education. We know from the very beginning of the Republic that education has been a major concern of Socrates's. The cave is an image of it. It's a way of summarizing his basic thoughts about education. Construct the following image in your minds. Use your imagination and imagine prisoners in a cave. Their legs and their necks are shackled, and as a result, they are unable to turn their heads. They're forced to look in one direction only, at the wall in front of them. On the wall in front of them are projected images. These images are generated by puppets which are behind them. They can't see these puppets because their necks are shackled. There is a fire behind these puppets which is casting the shadows on the wall. Very strange image. As always, whatever you end up thinking about Plato as a philosopher, you won't be able to deny the fact that he's a marvelous writer, and in this case, he's a marvelous storyteller. These are very strange people down at the bottom of a cave. Nonetheless, says Socrates, they are like us. He uses those exact words at 515a. In what conceivable way could they be like us? Well, I think we're prepared to answer that question because we've just studied the divided line, and we paid particular attention to the issue of images. These prisoners who are like us are seeing images. They, because they can't turn their heads, don't know that they're seeing images. They think they're seeing reality when in fact all that is in front of them are shadows. They are like us because we treat the sensible world in the same way. We ordinary people tend to believe that what we can touch with our hands, see with our eyes, is reality. You recall from the divided line that corresponding to sensible objects on the left side of the line is trust on the right side. I think now we're in a position to understand that word. We trust reality. We trust the reports that we get from our senses and believe that what we're seeing actually exists. But in doing so, we're like prisoners who are trapped in the world of images. We just don't know that they are images. One way of thinking about the cave is to imagine a movie theater. Very similar, actually. If you think of a darkened movie theater, everybody is looking at the screen, the projector is behind them. As the movie gets more and more enthralling, you absolutely forget that there's a projector behind you, and you are treating these images, this spectacle in front of your eyes as if it were reality. This is why we can cry or cheer at a movie. We forget it's only an image. I make this comparison between the parable of the cave and the modern day movie theater because certainly in our day and age, we live in a world that's increasingly dominated by images. If Plato were to appear on our streets in today's world, I think he'd be just astonished at the ubiquitous presence of images. Of course, we spend so much time on our computers, on the internet, on TV, with DVDs. We are very easily trapped into thinking that these images that we see with our eyes are in fact reality. Plato would caution us and say, be careful. Don't become intoxicated with your images. Don't become so dependent on your screens. As a university professor, I'm always struck by the need that modern-day students have for visual images to accompany lectures. They're very impatient with lectures that don't have all sorts of spectacle going on with it. Education for Socrates is turning around. This is the dominant metaphor of the parable of the cave. You will perhaps even remember the very beginning of Plato's Republic. Socrates is headed home to Athens proper, and he is forced to turn around and come back into the Piraeus with Polemarchus. As often is the case in Book One, that was a foreshadowing of the story of the cave. The main idea that Socrates tries to communicate in his imagery of education is that it requires a certain kind of force. A prisoner, and we're all prisoners, prisoners of images, a prisoner must be compelled, a word you find at 515c, to stand up and turn around and start to make his or her way out of the cave. Obviously, there has to be a compulsion of some sort because, for one thing, these prisoners have been locked into their positions. They need assistance in unloosening their bonds, and it's going to be very painful. Just treat this image at face value for a second. And you'll know, of course, if you've been sitting a long time and if your head hasn't been turning, if you've been, for example, on an airplane for a long flight, it's very painful to get up and move around. It's painful at first. And that is, says Socrates, exactly what education is like. It's painful. It's painful for another reason. When this prisoner is liberated by some sort of teacher and forced to turn around and start to make way upwards out of the cave, the prisoner will see the puppets and the prisoner will see the fire that is casting the shadows. And this is going to be painful in more than one sense. It's going to be painful because the light from the fire will be rather difficult to look at. You know what happens when you move from a darkened space into a more illuminated space. It hurts your eyes. It will be painful in another deeper sense, however. It will be painful because the prisoner who is now liberated will realize that what he had taken to be reality, these images flickering before his eyes, wasn't reality at all. This is a terrible experience that students have to go through. They have to realize that what they thought was true is in fact not true. What they thought was real perhaps isn't so real. What they thought was reality in fact was only an image. Exactly the language we were developing in our study of the divided line. In fact, says Socrates, 515e, the prisoner has to be dragged out of the cave. Once reaching the top, getting into the surface of the earth, the prisoner will be bathed in sunlight. And this, again, will be terribly painful. The sun, of course, is even much brighter than the fire. It will take a while for the prisoner's eyes to become adjusted to the bright light. Eventually, those eyes will become accustomed to it. And at that point, the prisoner is no longer a prisoner. The prisoner sees reality for what it is. The prisoner will see trees and animals and the moon and the stars, and in fact, eventually, will even be able to glimpse the sun itself. You remember our discussion of the idea of the good. The sun is, Socrates says, the child of the good. The sun is analogous to the good. This is clearly at work in the cave story. The process of education starts at the bottom of the cave, where we are only surrounded by images. It ends up traversing the various stages of the divided line until we reach the top, the sun, or analogously, the idea of the good. I think it's important here to take a step back and reflect on this metaphor that Socrates develops in order to express his conception of education. Education is turning around. Let me suggest to you a competing image of education, which I think will shed some light on Socrates' conception of education. This is, I would say, unfortunately, the image of education we live with in our time. I think for us, education tends to be conceived as the reception of information. We live, we're told many, many times, in the information age. You can go on to your internet connection and get all the information you want. The computer is astonishing at providing it for us. I sometimes think of this conception of education as the empty head conception of education. Think of your head being opened up and information, data, facts are just poured into the empty head. Very often students who are quite accustomed to this model of education will sit rather passively in a university course and just take notes. They are accustomed to the professor dispensing facts, dispensing little tiny bits of wisdom which they receive. The Socratic model is very different. This is a conception of education as turning around. This is a conception of education as revolutionary, because that, in fact, is what revolution means, a turning around. It's a conception of education that requires great struggle and, in fact, requires pain. You remember that this prisoner has to be dragged out of the cave. What that suggests is that the Socratic goal of education, and I believe we already know this about Socrates from our studies so far, is to make us uncomfortable, uncomfortable with conventional reality, uncomfortable with traditional opinions. The overwhelming philosophical demand is to think for oneself. And this is not easy, because when you think for yourself, you challenge conventional wisdom, you try to move upwards on the divided line, you are unwilling to treat images as reality and demand that reality be treated as reality. I think this is a very useful way of shedding some light on Socrates as a character in Plato's dialogue. Socrates, as we now know, is a rather strange person. I would take you all the way back to the opening scene of the Republic for a reminder. The first thing he does when he meets the old man Cephalus is to ask him, what's it like to be so old? How does it feel to be close to death? A question that conventional manners would certainly prohibit most of us from asking. Socrates is aggressive. At times, he's almost crude in the bluntness of his questioning. I think we now can get a sense of why he acts this way. He is trying to destabilize us. He's trying to shake us up, get us to think for ourselves, get us to make a break with what everybody else has been telling us. If Socrates would appear on our streets today, I think he would say, especially to young people, unplug those computers of yours. They're wonderful at dispensing little bits of information. Very impressive tools indeed. However, that's not the same thing as thinking. Real thinking goes on inside of your minds. It requires effort. It requires even this painful procedure that's described in the cave. After the prisoner is fully liberated and is bathing in the sunshine of the real world on top, something strange again happens. The liberated prisoner is compelled, 519c, to return to the cave in order to share his illumination. The cave is perhaps the single best story in the history of Western philosophy that expresses the theme of enlightenment. And I mean with that word something very literal, bringing light. The prisoner is forced to return to the cave in order to shed light in that darkness. This is, of course, the philosopher king, the philosopher queen. We have been talking about such a person for some time now. This is the person, the philosopher, who understands the idea of the good, which is mimicked by the sun in the parable of the cave, and who brings that understanding into the cave, or to put it another way, into the city, the polis, in order to help bring the polis up, to bring justice, to bring goodness, to make it a better place. Glaucon, who is never reluctant to ask a hard question, objects, and he says, "Wait a minute, Socrates, isn't this rather unfair to the philosopher? We're forcing the philosopher, who is bathing in the sunshine, to go back into this dark, smoky cave. Aren't we," Glaucon asks, and I'm referring to line 519d, "aren't we doing the philosopher an injustice? We're making him or her do something that's contrary to their nature." Perhaps you remember that a basic principle of Socrates' city, and this goes all the way back to the first city that we discussed in Book 2, is the idea of the division of labor. You recall the simplest city has only 4 or 5 people, the shoemaker, the farmer, the carpenter. And the shoemaker must be good at making shoes. We would never ask a shoemaker to become a carpenter, and we wouldn't ask a carpenter to become a farmer. Implicit in Glaucon's question, then, is the objection that the philosopher is being treated unfairly or unjustly because he or she is now being required to do 2 jobs. First job is to be a philosopher. It's a very hard job. You have seen some of the difficulties involved with it by reading the divided line and the idea of the good passages. The second job that the philosopher is now being forced to do is to rule the city. So which is it? What is the philosopher's job? Is it to be a philosopher or to rule the city? It's not just, Glaucon says, to ask philosophers to do both. Some commentators believe that this is actually a fatal flaw in Plato's entire project, and we'll come back to that issue. Perhaps you can imagine Socrates' response to Glaucon's objection, very similar to his reasoning that we've encountered many times in the Republic. He says to Glaucon, "The happiness of any one individual, whether it's the philosopher or anyone else, is not my concern. I'm trying to construct a just city, a perfectly good city, and my overriding concern is the goodness of the whole, not the goodness of any individual. So if the philosopher would rather bathe in the sunshine, too bad. The demands of the city require that the philosopher rule the city. This is the famous third wave we discussed earlier. So therefore, justice, says Socrates, objecting to Glaucon's objection, justice requires the philosopher to be forced to go back into the cave, into the city. In this context, Socrates makes two comments that I think are very interesting and worth thinking about. And these comments come right out of the parable of the cave story. He says at 520d, and I'll paraphrase it, the best city, and in fact, the only really good city, can be one in which those who rule are least eager to rule. I think we should think about this statement a little bit further. Recall a comment I made earlier about democracy, which is always on Plato's mind in the Republic. In a democracy, whether it's an American democracy or an Athenian democracy, opposing candidates always have one thing in common. They want the job. They want to be elected. In American politics, it's so hard to get elected. The campaigns are so long, they require such monumental effort that only someone, whether Democrat or Republican, who is hugely in love with the idea of being president can manage to go through such an arduous campaign. So this is a situation the opposite of what Socrates thinks is required for a truly just city. If there is going to be a successful city, the person who rules must be like the liberated prisoner, who would much prefer to stay up on earth bathing in the sun than to come down and actually rule. In the same vein, Socrates says the following at 521a, and I'll quote this directly. If you discover a life better than ruling for those who are going to rule, it is possible that your well-governed city will come into being. Very much the same point. In order for a truly good city to exist, there must be a kind of life that's better than ruling. Let me try to give you some suggestions about this line. And to do so, I'll go back to an earlier theme that we discussed when we were discussing the idea of the good. You recall a comment Socrates makes about the idea of the good. If we don't know what it is, nothing else that we have is really good. I use the example of money as a way of illustrating this principle. Socrates' point is, money is not good or bad. Money, despite the fact that it seems very good to most people, is actually neutral. If you have a lot of money, you can use it well and be benefited, or if you have a lot of money, you can use it very badly and it will damage you. So it's neither good nor bad, beneficial nor harmful. It's neutral. In order to make it good, we must know how to use it, and in order to know how to use it, we must have some access to the idea of the good. Now, I'm discussing money because I think the point is exactly parallel to the one Socrates makes about ruling. If there were nothing else in the world except money as a good, then the quest for money would be endless. If I had $1 million, it wouldn't be enough. I'd want $2 million. If I had $100 million, I'd want $200 million. And on it would go. Money would simply beget money. I think Socrates' point is very similar about political power, political rule. If there is no guiding principle, no higher life, no greater good than political power, then political power would have no objective other than itself. And what would happen if there were no higher objective? Then political power would want to do nothing else except expand. This is a kind of diagnosis of expansionism. There are regimes, and Socrates would think of Sparta, perhaps he'd even think of Athens itself in the 5th century, whose only objective is to get bigger, to expand itself, to see itself and bring itself into other countries. And this is a catastrophe, according to Socrates. This can never be just, because just like the quest for money never ends, and therefore can never be satisfied, so too would the quest for political power, if there were no higher principle to guide it, never be satisfied, never be just. Or think of the argument that Socrates makes against hedonism. Remember the definition of hedonism. It's the position that pleasure is the highest good. And Socrates says, when he's discussing the idea of the good, that the majority of people, the hoi polloi, they very frequently believe that pleasure is the good. For Socrates, that's a catastrophic mistake, because Socrates believes that there's a distinction to be made between good pleasures and bad pleasures. And if there's a distinction between good and bad pleasures, there must be some standard other than pleasure which measures the goodness of pleasure. If there were no such standard, then the only option available would be to maximize one's pleasures. And that's an endless, unsatisfying, and finally degrading form of life. Again, the parallel can be made between pleasure and political power. If there were no life better than ruling, then all that would be available would be ruling. And if that were the case, the only option for the ruler would be expansion, expansion, expansion. If I'm ruling 1 million people today, I want to rule 2 million people tomorrow. This is a description of the tyrant, who will be discussed at great length shortly in the Republic. And it is, believes Socrates, a catastrophic fate for a city. Therefore, to go back to these wonderfully rich lines at 520D and 521A, it's crucial for the well-being of a political system that there be some goal, some standard, some principle that is itself beyond politics. This is captured beautifully in the parable of the cave. Precisely because the philosopher who reaches the top and gets to enjoy the sun doesn't want to go back into the cave and rule the prisoners. He is most adept and most qualified to do so. The person who is least eager to rule makes the best ruler. Let me close this lecture by simply listing a few questions or even problems with the parable of the cave. I would give you as an exercise to see if you could complete this, try to map all the little objects in the cave story, the shadows, the prisoners, the puppets, the fire, onto the divided line. That's not so easy to do, but it's fun to try. I'll ask some questions, though, that will make it a bit harder. Who are these puppet handlers? That's a phrase that Socrates uses at 514a. Well, seemingly these are the people who are responsible for the images. In today's world, they might be movie directors or TV producers or web designers. Interesting question. Who are they that handle the puppets? What does the fire represent? Fire is an artificial tool in the cave. Two very difficult questions which are related. finally, what really is the value of seeing the sun when you come back to the cave? Let's just take the image very seriously. If I see the sun, how will that help me understand what's going on in the cave? Those are two separate worlds. Why does knowing one help me understand the other? And the last question is the one I've already mentioned. Must an injustice be done to the philosopher when he or she is forced to return to the cave?